top of my page here, I have little things to do, you know. When you go to speak, you make notes to yourself to be sure you remember them. You know, like first thing, John, take out your chewing gum, you know, for that. And then adjust your hearing aid. You know, when he said, our speaker this morning, it came through to me, our singer this morning. And I thought, good night, we're going to lose him for sure. By the way, did I bring my Bible? Oh, yeah. Another thing you're supposed to do is bring your Bible when you first come. Thank you. Appreciate that. My, my. I'd go to church just to hear Jim White take the offering, wouldn't you? I really would. I mean, it just makes you feel so good about giving. Well, Jim's wonderful background and his love for God sure qualifies him. And I appreciate being with you this morning. In a moment, we're going to have another word of prayer. But in the meantime, do each of you have your handout? If it does, well, you wave it at me. And see, if you don't, well, the guys will be sure. Okay. Now, the reason you have a handout is a little different than Kirk. Kirk had a handout. I won't be able to get through my message because I never get through my message. Mr. Ward encourages me. He said, well, if you didn't chase so many rabbits, this fellow here wants to come forward. No, he wants a handout. The altar call is open. If anybody wants to come forward now, you just come on down. The fellows here, John and Paul, and the fellows will counsel with you, Jerry. So you just come on down. If you may not be under conviction that much, you might be frightened to death. But you do have it, and I have given this message before. I have several titles. In fact, this is not my message at all. It's Dawson Trotman's message. And I've copied it and tried to make application, but when I speak to servicemen, the title of this message is Cars, Cuties, and Cash. And then when I speak to university fellows, the title of this message is Girls, Gold, and Glory. And then when I speak to old men, it's Pleasure, Prosperity, and Prestige. Some of them a little short on the pleasure part. But our key verse is 1 John 2:15-16. You notice the message is rather complicated, don't you? Well, I like complicated, deep messages like this. Well, and one verse, 1 John 2:15-16. If you know it in any kind of a translation, well, you quote it along with me, and we'll quote 1 John 2:15-16. Now, some of you are going to be confused because somebody's going to be quoting in a different translation next to you. It's going to sound like a tongues meeting, but that's all right. Good Pentecostal people have good tongues meetings, so we'll have one right now. Ready? 1 John 2:15-16. Ready? Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. Now that's going to convict a lot of you because that's in the King James. And most of you quoted in the King James. That means you've known that verse a long time. But let's pray. Ready? Father, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ that you'll open our hearts to the Word and the Word to our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. In the way of introduction, Luke 9:62 says, no man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. Now, it's rather hard for modern people to realize what that means. No man having put his hand to the plow. In the old plow stock, the old single horse or mule or oxen, you had to plow like this. There's nothing to guide it. And there's no way in the world you could plow straight furrow except looking straight ahead. I tried looking back at the birds and all such as that, and my father called me one time. And I didn't do that anymore. But you'll plow up the crop and you just can't plow a straight furrow looking around or looking back. You must look ahead. Luke 14:27 says, "And whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple." We have a staff member by the name of Lewis Hill. He's from Georgia, and when he says his name fast, it sounds like Lucille. And so we call him Lucille. Well, Lucille was preaching up in Lincoln last year, and he made a little statement, and I've been using it ever since. He said, it was a men's group, he says, "Now, fellas, suppose the Bible really is true." Just for a moment, he says, "Let's suppose the Bible really is true." Well, in Luke 14:27 says, "Whosoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple." Now, if that's true, that's a narrow gate. If it is true. Now, you'll have to settle or not whether it's true. 1 Chronicles 12:33, "Of Zebulun, which is went forth to war, expert in war with all instruments of war, 50,000 which could keep rank, they were not of double heart." I just read a book with the old breed by E.B. Sledge. Dr. Sledge preaches over in Montevallo, Alabama University. I mean, he teaches over there now. But when he was a kid, World War II, he made the beachhead at Peleliu and Okinawa. But he went through boot camp in San Diego, and he says two men have impressed his life, made a deep impression on his life. One is his father, and he says the other is a drill sergeant. He says his corporal would show up on the grinder at 4:30 in the morning with shoe shine, with such a glow you could see yourself in the shoes. And his clothes were fit him like the finest tailor in London had done the work. And he was all chest. He said he had the meanest, grayest blue eyes of any man he'd ever seen. And he'd run the fellows through their paces before breakfast, and then after breakfast. And by noon, the guys would just be fagged out, and he'd hardly be breathing deep. And Sledge, they called him Sledgehammer, he says, "I learned to hate him with a perfect hatred." It was a pure and unadulterated hatred. And then they taught him hand to hand with how to use knives, because they said the Japanese would come into the tents at night. And so it taught him that, and he'd almost break his arm. And one sergeant was just a little slow one day, and the kid cut his fingers. The private cut his fingers. The sergeant just held his hand and let it drip. And while he continued with his lecture, you see. And so, Sledge, all the way on the transport, he mauled over this man that he hated. Then they made the beachhead at Peleliu, and the first night the Japanese came in for a hand-to-hand combat, and they killed them. They killed all the Japanese. And Sledge says, "You know, that blankety-blank back in San Diego saved my life, because he taught me how to fight. He taught me how to fight close in. He taught me how to kill fast. And now I'm alive, and they're dead." That's the whole object of fighting. I know the modernists got all this deal, and I almost wept when we were depicted last week as the aggressors in Europe and the aggressors. And my wife grabs her pen and starts writing the senators right away, you know, in Japanese. No, the only way you're going to fight an enemy is they must die. And I want to live. That's where you fight an enemy. And if you get any other mamby-pamby way, you're not going to live to be 75 years old. You're going to be dead. And so he said, "No man, having put his hand to the plow and looks back, I can't use him. I can't use him." He says, 50,000 which could keep rank, they were not double heart. You know what my number is right now? My number is 500. We're up to 300 now, a little over 300. I'm looking for 500 men. You say, John, isn't that kind of counting? Yeah, that's counting. John, isn't that leaning on the flesh? I hope not. But his Lord have to forgive me. Because I'm looking for men. John, why do you start your conference at Thursday night? Why don't you start it at Friday night like everybody else when men get off to work? I says, I'm looking for that 195 men that show up Thursday night. Have you ever known fellas that went deer hunting on Saturday afternoon? Why is it that when I arrange a pheasant shoot up in Kansas, I can get more than mine and Ralph's bus and both can carry? We can get more guys than we get. How did you guys get off? Well, we took leave. You see? Just looking for a few men. And that's 1 Kings 2:3. And keep the charge of the Lord your God to walk in his ways, to keep his statutes and his commandments, his judgments, his testimonies as written in the law of Moses, that you may prosper wherever you go. And that's what he wants us to do. He wants us to prosper wherever we go. Single-minded. What's your job? What's your job? Well, you know, fellas, I got the vision in about 45 minutes. Sometimes it takes years to get the vision. People fast and pray. Well, I was quite fat, actually. I was going up the ladder there at, going up the stairway at, we had a little place in Oakland, California, where, we met. This was 1945 by this time, and I came off the ship. My ship was tied up in San Francisco. I came off the ship. In those days, we had a Bible, no book under our arm, navigators, and, I had war ribbons, you know, and hash marks and all that kind of good stuff. And Doss was coming down the stairway, and I was going up, and he said, Johnny, I was hoping I could see you. You got a little time. All I had was time, you know. I said, sure, Doss. So we went out on Lake Merritt. That's right in the middle of Oakland, California, beautiful lake. And we lay down on the grass, and Don said, Johnny, what's the Lord been teaching you these days? So I broke out my verse pack, and I said, well, Doris, I've been working on these verses, really got a blessing. So I shared some of the blessings that I got out of my verses and so on, and he shared some blessings, and we had a prayer together, leaning on our elbows there on the grass. And Doris said, John, what's God laid on your heart after the conflict? I said, well, Doris, I don't know. I thought about going back to Alabama, maybe going back to school and be a Southern Baptist preacher. He said, John, I think you make a good one. I thought of anything else. I said, well, yes, I had. I thought I might, you know, maybe go be in youth work. And I thought I ought to take something real profound to Doss. You know, Doss, if you don't get them young, you don't get them, you know. I'm amazed at the profound things I've said to my elders over the years, you know. But he just let it go by. And, he said, you know what, Johnny? He says, if you raise up one disciple, he says, he could be in youth work and you could be a pastor and you could be in two places at one time. So we talked on a little further and mission field came up and I said, you know, Doss, that's where my heart is. That's really where my heart is, Doss. I'd like to go to the foreign mission field. That's really what I do. He said, well, John, Maybe God will send you. He said, you know, John, if you raise up two disciples, one could be in youth work and one could be a pastor and you could go to the mission field. And you could be three places at one time. And then just like he thought of it for the first time, he said, you know what, Johnny? We were laying on the grass and I was on my right elbow and he was on his left elbow. He's right up in my face. And he says, you know what, Johnny? If you never figure out just what you ought to do, you can spend your whole life raising up disciples and sending them all over the world. That was That was 49 years ago. I've never figured out what I ought to do. But there are some hindrances, man. There really are some hindrances. One of the hindrances is purity. God's basic order is that man should be married. But there are some exceptions. And Jesus, no doubt, was one of those exceptions. He had a special mission. Paul, no doubt, had a special calling. But by and large, it's best that men should be married. I was a single man for 35 years. It was a tough life. It was a tough life. There was no pot of gold at the foot of the rainbow. And then God, in his due time, he gave me a wife. And he gave me God's choice. He gave me a wife that's been such a blessing. My wife prays. She's praying for you fellas right now. And she prays for fellas. I just get amazed. And sometimes I have a little Bible study of servicemen and fellas. I have about five guys. We meet on Thursday night. My, we're having a ball. A couple of them are rather old, 23 years old. And others are about 28 years old. And just thrills my heart to get together with these guys. And I tell them sea stories. That's what they want me to do, you know. They get me off, you know. I remember when we were in New Zealand, I was visiting from up and down the country, and we went to the southernmost city in the world, Invercargill. It's right on the tip of New Zealand, beautiful city. We had a contact down there by the name of Bill Pauley. Bill was a 23-year-old carpenter. He'd done his apprenticeship, and he was shot. Had a little business. Mom and Dad was living. He lived with them. So we had a good time, and I met some of Bill's fellows that he was discipling. Bill had been contacted before, and so we had a beautiful time. And we got home, and Mom, about 3 days later, Mom said, Daddy, I just got burdened for Bill. I said, oh, really? I'm praying for a wife for him? No, she said, he won't make it. I said, sweetheart. I said, Bill has a little business down at Invercargill. I said, he's one of our top men. He said, Daddy, he won't make it. Well, what should I do? She said, you should invite him up to Hamilton. I said, well, honey, he's got his business. His mom and dad is there. She said, Daddy, he won't make it. So I prayed about it. And so, you know, the verse that says, listen to your wife, you know. There should be. During the meantime, Bill's dad passed away, godly man, left with his mother's widow. I approached Bill about moving up. He did. And to cut it short, Bill Pauley, man in his mid-40s now, is our key contact there in the city of Hamilton, a disciple maker and a general contractor. Over and over, I've seen that the Holy Spirit of God using people. I just praise God that He gave me the wife that He did. One time we were at Glen Eyrie and we had some young ladies there, and she said, Daddy, I got a burden that Sally should go to work for Gene and Irma War. I said, well, honey, I have just had some time with Gene, and he has had people in his home, and this business of having young people in your home is good for other people, Gene says, but for him, he's had some bad experiences of having people in his home. I don't think it'll fly. I said, well, honey, she said, I just got this burden. I said, well, talk to Irma. So she talked to Irma, and Irma said, well, you'll have to talk to Gene yourself. So I backed out, and Irma backed out, and so Helen had to talk to Gene, and Gene said, oh, no, Helen. And she said, Gene, if you'll take Sally into your home, if it don't work, I won't ask you for anything else. But Gene said, well, Helen, if you feel that way about it, you know. She said, I feel that way. Sally moved in with Regina and Irma. Now she's married to John Repass. And they have this lovely family, and her lovely son is right here. It's not good that man should be alone. It's best that he have a wife. It's best he has a wife that spends time with God. People that hear says, hi, it's Helen. I said, she's tired. Well, really? I said, yeah, she's a full-time grandmother and a full-time bedmaker and a full-time house cleaner. And then she's full-time looking after her husband, and an old sick husband is worse, so, you know, she's tired. See? Therefore, God made him a helpmate for him. Scripture says, whosoever finds a wife finds a good thing. Houses and riches are the inheritance of father, but a prudent wife is from the Lord. Nevertheless, to avoid sexual immorality, let each man have his own wife, and each wife her own husband. However, man has a basic problem. James 1:15. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. And fellas, we got a lot to pay in our country, and we're going to have a lot to pay even more. Because sin brings forth death. How to avoid it? How to avoid problems. 2 Timothy 2:22. Flee also youthful lust. You avoid problems just like Eric avoids hijackers. He gets out the door as fast as he can. See, you know, avoids them. Flee youthful lust. Proverbs 4:23. Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Fellas, don't look at the wrong things. Wrong things will feed your mind. See, our mind feeds our eyes feed our mind, and our mind feeds our soul. You know. So let thine eyes look right on, Proverbs 4:25-26. Let thine eyelid look straight before thee. Ponder the path of thy feet, and let all thy ways be established. Dearly beloved, 1 Peter 2:11. I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts, which wars against the soul. You see, Deuteronomy 4:9, only take heed to thyself and keep thy soul diligently. It's your soul that these kind of things eat at. So avoid it. We're going to have some more on purity, so I'm going to leave that there. Possessions. Right attitude toward possessions. Lay not up for yourselves treasures on earth, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. We have a responsibility with possessions. You can't abandon it. You can't abandon it by giving it all away like I tried a couple of times. When I got out of the fleet, missionaries come along, and I wanted to be full-time in the Lord's work and live by faith, and so I gave away all the money I had to missions. I kept the $400 discharge money and gave the rest of it all away. And the missionaries come through next month, and I didn't have $1 to give them. I just given it all away. And the missionaries come through next month. They were sending missionaries to Japan in those days, and they were coming through Oakland, California, where I lived, and I didn't have any money to give them next month, you see. So you can't abandon your responsibility by giving it all. We're to be God's stewards. God has given us some of this world's goods, and get some help. There's a lot of help available. Burkett and others, there's lots of help available. We have seminars. I don't know that we have any workshops on it this year, but get some help on how to handle possessions, see? But the problem we have with possessions, the problem we have, the scripture says, it's the love of money, 1 Timothy 6:10, that's the root of all evil. Now let's go back to Lucille's supposition. Let's suppose the Bible really is true. The love of money is the root of all evil. You say, well, John, that don't mean exactly like that. Well, what does it mean? Well, my Bible says the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Okay, I'll buy that. You know, close enough. See? It's the love. Love. One of our fellas, I used to check his verses, and one of the men called him, George, you go into the conference? He said, no, I can't go. He said, really? What's the problem? He said, well, I just bought a new car and I don't have the money. Well, I don't think he does. I don't think he really has money. He just spent it on a car, see? Well, again, I just don't know very many people that go deer hunting on Saturday afternoon. You know, you make plans for it. You take leave for it. You save for it, you see. But don't let the love of money get to you. Now, I know some poor people who love money. They don't have all that much, but they love it. And I know some rich people that absolutely don't love money. They're just custodians, and they pray over it, and they give away a heavy percent, a greater percent than I do, you know. And I just praise God. So that's one of the things that you want to sort out. We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can take nothing out. I want to get to this last one, pride. Because pride, fellas, has been one of the things that have plagued me, and it's brought me more heartache. I really feel before the Lord that I got a pretty good grip on the love of money. I really do. I really do. I really feel I got a pretty good balance. I've checked with fellas, and they say, yeah, John, I believe you got a good balance on that, you know? And I fight the same battle of lust that any other man does, but I know how to have victory. You abstain, and you don't look at things you're not supposed to, and even in your older age, you still have to go for walks or jogs or still have to take cold showers. I mean, you do the things that you did when you were young to fight the battle, more in your mind than in your body, but nevertheless, your mind will condemn you to hell as well as your body. So you have to work on your mind. But pride, I mean, pride will just eat you. Pride will eat you, and you can cover it. I know some people who are eating up with bitterness, and they're covering it with big salve. You know, sometimes if I burn the toast, I take a big helping of jelly and just kind of cover it, you know, just kind of cover my mistakes, you see. And so you can do that. Second Corinthians 7:10-17, but let he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. But not he that contendeth himself is approved, but whom the Lord commendeth. Thus saith the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom, neither let the mighty man glory in his might. Let not the rich man glory in his riches. I've been fairly strong all my life. Bricklayer, I jogged up and up 3 years ago. I up until a few months ago, I did chores like, you know, help a fella. In fact, one of my fellas now, I want to lay up a foundation for him. A good one of our disciple makers, and he's building his own house, and I just enjoy it. I won't work too fast. I work about 5 or 6 hours a day, but I've done that. But then the Lord comes along and said, John, you're proud. John, you can walk most guys down in the pheasant field, 40 years old. You can walk them down. John, you enjoy seeing them look for a jug of water. Yeah. You enjoy that, don't you, John? Well, yeah, Lord, it's a lot of fun. You know, I just, you know, get to them. Well, he says, I want you to look at me. I don't want to look at yourself. So I take off my clothes and look in the mirror, and I say, well, Lord, you know, this, you know, this is no bundle of muscle shit. He said, I know, but you're proud. You're proud. And you know, God has ways of taking us and putting us through the mill. And so 17 days in the hospital, looking up and counting the cracks, trying to review your verses, and then you doze off, you know. No. Pride. One of the ways that we know that we're proud is not taking reproof. Scripture says, reprove not a scorner, lest he hate thee. Rebuke a wise man, he'll love thee. Give instruction to a wise man, he'll be yet wiser. Teach a just man, and he will increase in learning. It's awfully hard to teach people. It's awfully hard to tell people things. And when I do find a man or a girl that really wants to learn, boy, I stay with them. I had the most interesting experience in the hospital. I've had this before. My veins kind of jump around. They're kind of hard to find, you know. And, you see, and I don't mind it, you know, if they push in there and they miss one. But when they start looking for it with the needle already in there, see, it bothers me a little bit, you see. So the girl come in to put in an IV, and I said to Miss, you probably put up with fussy old men a lot. You know, I don't want to be a fussy old man, but I wanted to tell you something. My veins jump around. I said, I don't know how you say that medically. Oh, she said, Mr. Crawford, I think we can handle it all right. Sweet girl. Well, she missed it. In fact, she missed it all three times. And so the second one come in, and she missed it. And then the supervisor come, and rougher than a cop, but boy, she flat stick got it in there. The second time they need to put one in, I said, pardon me, you know, I said, I know you girl put up with these things all the time, and I don't want to be a fussy old man, and please forgive me before I even ask, would you? But my veins jump around. And I knew she was an apprentice because there was a guy right behind her, watching her, see? And so she missed it all three times. And lo, he got down there and he missed it and they both left. And then the supervisor come in. Third one come and I said, are you a supervisor? This is the third time it was installed. And she said, well, not at the moment, but yes, Mr. Crawford, I've been a supervisor for years. I said, I appreciate that. I didn't give her any instructions. She got the first time. The fourth time, first one come in, and I went through my little deal. And the second would come in, and I went through my little deal, and it took the supervisor, you see. It's awfully hard to tell people things. It really is, you know. But if you learn to take reproof, if you learn to take instruction, fellas, I am in excellent shape because before I was saved, I decided that I would learn from my masters. I'm running over time, so you'll have to drink coffee fast. I was apprenticed, and I worked for this old man, Mr. Lamb. He didn't talk much, except when he scolded me. But he could do perfect work. I asked him one time, I said, Mr. Lamb, I said, what's the best thing to fill a crack with? He says, wood, son. I said, yes, sir, but suppose you make a mistake and make a crack. He says, get you another man. See, that was his idea, see? So I determined that I would take it from my elders. I was lost as a goose. Lost as a goose. But you know what? That paid me money in the bank. That one little old thing. And then when I got saved, I began to read these things in the Bible that you're supposed to take it from your elders, you know? And I just want to pass on to you that I can give you illustration after illustration where I have gone to people and asked their advice, and they saw that I was serious, and they helped me. And lo and behold, there's money in the bank because I went to these people, and I wasn't so all-fired, headstrong. One of the things that you young people you have is buying a home. They're pell-mell to buy a home, and you try to teach them, and you try to hold them back, and it's just awfully, awfully hard to do. But, fellas, let me lay it on you. Pride will eat your lunch any day of the week. So, get before the Lord. I know we got a lot on purity, and I know we've hit a lot on possessions over the years, and I know some of you guys could do, I've heard some of your workshops on possessions and budgeting and stuff, and I just praise God for you. And I want to encourage you, fight that battle of pride and keep it committed to the Lord. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you for this good time together. In Jesus' name, amen.